This is WBSM On Demand. It's time for South Coast Now with Chris McCarthy. Streaming live on WBSM.com and the WBSM app. Call 508-996-0500. Text us using app chat on the WBSM app. Now, Chris McCarthy.
Good morning. Welcome to the program. I'm Chris McCarthy. It's a beautiful day out there. And if you'd like to call me, you can at 508-996-0500. There is a matter that deserves our attention. The mayor of New Bedford, John Mitchell, brought it up last week, but we had a lot last week to talk about. It is a matter of a violation of the open meeting law. The open meeting law is there for you and me, okay, citizens. It is there to prevent duplicity, dishonesty in government. It is there because that type of behavior used to be commonplace in the Commonwealth. Without the open meeting law, and let me tell you something. I've been constrained by the open meeting law as a government official, an elected official. Some of you out there who have had the honor and privilege of being on a board of selectmen, a city council member, a planning board, you really recognize the importance of the open meeting law. You don't have to be a journalist seeking information to know the importance of the open meeting law. What it is designed to do is to prevent skullduggery, to prevent the back room, the smoke-filled room. Although I guess now, well, there is still some smokes available, but anyway. It is to prevent things being done in secret, generally with the taxpayers' dollars, or ultimately with privileges. The open meeting law is something I know I can tell you that a lot of people try to make it like it's no big deal. Listen, it's a big deal. It's a big deal. When I was on a three-person board of selectmen, it meant that two of us could not have a phone call or conspire over lunch. It meant that two of us could not be in the same room alone, unless by coincidence. And even then, we had to be very circumspect, right? Because you don't want to even give the appearance of violating the open meeting law. But you New Bedford taxpayers have had a violation of the open meeting law. Quite frankly, I think you've had numerous violations of the open meeting law. But the mayor of New Bedford and his supporters have brought a lawsuit against the retirement board. For now, John Mitchell, Mayor Mitchell, if you missed this, check out the podcast from last Wednesday. We talked about it. We'll get an update from when he comes in tomorrow. But what basically happened is the retirement board, which consists of people appointed by the mayor, people who by statute are on the board, and representatives from the retired community. Now, the New Bedford pension system, like many systems in Massachusetts, has some problems. But most systems are in better shape than New Bedford's. The mayor has been attempting his versions of reform. He is generally resisted by the people who are on the pension board. But what has come to light, and there's no doubt about it, it's all spelled out in the minutes, is that the New Bedford Pension Retirement Board, the people who run the pension system, have violated the open meeting law. Now, the mayor's political supporters, appointees, have filed a lawsuit. They got a favorable judgment from a judge. Last week, I asked the communications director for the mayor to put, if he could put the lawsuit up on the city website. It may be there now. I have a copy of it. You have a copy. It's a public record. But I think it's a lot easier to find it if it's up on the city's website. It lays out the case, the charges, names everybody to include the people that brought the lawsuit. One of them is Bob Schilling, who's an appointee of the mayor until recently on the Zoning Board of Appeals. Bob's a friend of mine. You know he's been here on the program. Eric Jakes, the city solicitor, who's a taxpayer in the city of New Bedford. He's the lead plaintiff. They brought this against the Retirement Board of New Bedford. What's interesting is that the judge agrees. It's an illegal violation of the open meeting law. But you know who has to pay the fine? You do. You, the retirees. The fine for this violation of the open meeting law, $1,000, it's going to come out of the, ultimately, the taxpayers' money, right? No matter what pocket, it's always your pocket, the taxpayers of New Bedford. What I find interesting is that the mayor and his political appointees have brought this lawsuit about the open meeting law. The open meeting law is a serious law that often gets ignored. I like that the mayor is enforcing and his appointees are enforcing the open meeting law. I like that a judge agreed. He took the minutes of the meeting. He took the outcome of the meeting. He took the facts, everything surrounding the meeting, the judge did. And he came to the determination that, yes, in fact, the open meeting law was violated. And he's fining the city of New Bedford. But what are the ramifications on the individuals that are on that board? And what is the overall message? In my opinion, it is that John Mitchell does not approve of nor stand by passively while people break the open meeting law. And I think that is excellent. I got to tell you something. When I was a selectman in Freetown, that open meeting law really got in my way. It really did. There were times I'd like to have picked the phone up and called Bob Robidoux or called Bruce Wilbur or called John Ashley, except that I couldn't do it. And they couldn't pick up the phone and call me because it's a violation of the law, and I really try not to flagrantly violate the law. So I appreciate that John Mitchell and his appointees, Bob Schilling, a lawyer, appointee of the mayor to the Zoning Board of Appeals, signed on to this lawsuit. Eric Jakes, a solicitor and appointee of the mayor, taxpayer in the city of New Bedford, he authored the lawsuit, and they brought it all the way to court, and they got a judgment against the members of the board, the retirement committee, right, the retirement board. Lenny Blageron. Actually, he's all over those minutes. It's worth your reading. In fact, Lenny says, and you retirees ought to think about this. He says, I'll take the blame. It's blame it on me. I'm the one who says, let's break the open meeting law. Somebody to that effect. It's all right there in the minutes. You can read it yourself. But yet, it's you, the taxpayers, that's paying the fine. Think about that. I think that everybody across the board who's on a meeting or elected to a board ought to follow the open meeting law. So does a judge, so does the attorney general. It does get enforced. It was no big deal. I know a lot of people in the city council tried to make it that way, but when Jack Spillane and the New Bedford Light and people here at this radio station raised the idea that all getting together to meet in a restaurant, a quorum, to have lunch, have dinner, a quorum, that's illegal. It's illegal. Creating an environment where you can violate the open meeting law, it violates the spirit of the open meeting law. So I think they've stopped doing that, although maybe they've just been less obvious about it. I know a number of counselors were thought less of by their colleagues, and it made their life a little more difficult because you have to have a quorum, have to have a majority. When they said, I'm not attending those meetings, because that's what they are. Those violations of the open meeting law, they're meetings. But what about the licensing board? It's clear to me, when you look at the minutes, when you watch the video of the meeting, they violated the open meeting law, the licensing board. They clearly had a directive from the mayor, and they decided before the meeting what they were going to do. That's a violation of the open meeting law. 508-996-05. That's how you can get on the program. But again, the mayor, with his political appointees, has pointed out there is a violation of the open meeting law. They got a judgment against the retirement board. You read the minutes. They knew they were doing it. Lenny Blageron, former New Bedford police officer, member of the retirement board, he said, I'll take the blame. Something to that effect. It's in the minutes. I read them. They're part of the lawsuit. They're in the case. It's a very well-drafted lawsuit, drafted by Eric Jakes. But how does it get satisfied? The mayor has taken a stance against violating the open meeting law. And he went so far as to get a judgment. I think that's excellent. That's good government. But what about his appointees on the licensing board? Is the city council just going to sign them up, broom them on through? When it's very clear they violated the open meeting law. It is very clear they had they did it twice, by the way. You look at those minutes. They had a decision. They clearly knew what they were doing. How do three people think in concert to come to a decision, a unified decision between three men? Well, they obviously met ahead of time. They had phone calls, emails, they conversed, they decided, they debated amongst themselves. You were excluded. This is a multi-million dollar decision to ban smaller bottles of alcohol in the city of New Bedford. You want to buy a smaller bottle of alcohol? You can't. That same decision was reached by elected town meeting members here in the town of Fairhaven. It was rejected, but ultimately by the elected or the people who showed up for town meeting in Mattapoisett, your legislative body, their legislative body in Mattapoisett, the legislative body here in Fairhaven. The city council was excluded. The licensing board made that decision clearly in a violation of the open meeting law. The same law that the mayor of New Bedford has gotten so exercised about, rightfully so, that his political appointees and his city solicitor drafted a lawsuit, got a judgment. But what about the licensing board? What about the licensing board? Stick around. We'll be right back. If you're on hold, stay there. 508-996-0. I have two phone lines open. If you'd like to get through, I'd love to hear from you. Stick around. Welcome back to the program. I'm Chris McCarthy, and make sure you always check out WBSM.com. We're going to have a big story coming up about the town of Fairhaven. I'll discuss it more, a little bit more now, and then we'll discuss a lot of it tomorrow. It is about the civil service, the removal of civil service by the town of Fairhaven. We'll have more about it at WBSM.com as the day progresses, but what it comes down to is that they're going to make some changes here in the town of Fairhaven. It is a very, very interesting thing. What I want to point to you in the direction of Mac Auto Sales. Mac Auto Sales, 180 River Street in New Bedford. They repair all makes and models. So if you need to get your car ready for the summer, and trust me, you do, I want you to call Mac Auto Sales and Repair. 508-565-6221. They're open weekdays, 9 to 5. If you have a foreign car, that's perfect. Bring them down. They specialize in servicing foreign automobiles at Mac Auto Sales. If you're in the market for a new-to-you car, maybe an additional car for your family, one for somebody who's just gotten their driver's license, check out Mac Auto Sales. They have quality used cars. Check them out. Tell them Chris McCarthy sent you. So the situation in New Bedford with the open meeting law violation. Watch for that by the retirement board. What it comes down to is the fifth seat, the tiebreaker seat on the retirement board. That is currently held by Chris Saunders, who's a friend of mine, and the treasurer of Bristol County. Good guy. Chris Saunders was elected by the other members of the retirement board to take that fifth seat. All right. And the mayor, had they not filled that seat at the meeting that they had that was illegal, right, with Chris Saunders. Chris wasn't involved in the illegal meeting. He was the person who was voted. He did not vote for himself. He wasn't on the board. So what happened was, at a meeting without the agenda being posted, they voted for the fifth person on the retirement board. They selected Chris Saunders. The mayor, had they not done that then, and even maybe today, because it was an illegal meeting, would have had the option to select his own appointee to be the fifth person, which would have allowed the mayor to get his reforms enacted, which he thinks will have an impact on the budget and you, the taxpayers. So this is no small thing. No small thing. Meetings in Massachusetts, and I would assume everywhere else, are governed by laws. For democracy to operate, it has to be within the guardrails, right? It has to be done the right way, at the right time. Which is why the town of Fairhaven has put out an immediate release, press release, regarding civil service. It is an ongoing issue, which I have to tell you, I have to give a lot of credit. Everyone does. To the Facebook page run by Christina Lopes, who has been talking about this in conjunction with other people, the civil service vote of the town of Fairhaven, the process to leave civil service. Was it done properly? She first drew my attention to this. She now got everybody's attention. So, citizen journalists are important. And we'll talk more about this in the next segment. I'm going to take a break coming up. But we have some really interesting information here from the town of Fairhaven, my town. Many of you live here. We just had an election. A lot of good turnout. A lot of great candidates in the race. And we've got some very important news for you about the town of Fairhaven. We'll have more at WBSM.com, but I'm going to talk more about this in the next segment. I want to appreciate the town of Fairhaven and the people from the town who got this information over to me in time for me to read it on the air. I can't really do an analysis of it right now. I will. We'll have more at WBSM.com, but we're going to take a quick break. When we come back, we'll talk more about the town of Fairhaven and anything else you'd like to talk about at 508-996-0. Stick around. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the program. I'm Chris McCarthy, and here is what we've learned from the town of Fairhaven. Basically, whoever instructed the previous Board of Selectmen, remember, we had an election. We have two new members of the Board of Selectmen, Andrew Saunders and Andrew Romano. It's a good year for Andrews. Remember, last time around, the town administrator, as far as I could tell, made the pick and then told the Board of Selectmen who the new chief of police was. That's how I understood the process to have gone down. They're throwing the process out, okay? Basically, I got this giant press release here in front of me. Here's the thing. The town of Fairhaven, the town administrator, the previous Board of Selectmen did it all wrong. Removed the town from the civil service process almost, but not enough. Okay? So what this press release says, and there'll be more about it at WBSM.com, is that they need to find another person. They're going to have to redo the process to replace Chief Myers, a very good guy and a very hard person to replace. Chief Michael Myers is a real good guy. But anyway, he's retiring, as you know, and unfortunately, the man who was chosen to replace him, however this breaks down, is going to have to compete again for the job because the process to remove the town from civil service was not done correctly. Now, that'll be up to the Board of Selectmen, the current Board of Selectmen, to figure out who made the mistake and to rectify it. Basically, they did it partially. It was done by a meeting, by a vote of the town meeting, to remove the city, remove the town of Fairhaven from civil service. But it was also required a vote of the town. Because back in 1936, when I first learned about this on the Facebook page for Fairhaven, a citizen-run page, that the city went into civil service by a vote at the ballot box in 1936. What's kind of funny is my grandparents would have voted in that election. That's pretty interesting, really. They lived on Chestnut Street. J. Leo McCarthy and family. So, anyway, way back in 36, when my grandfather was voting in Fairhaven and my grandmother was still alive voting in Fairhaven, my dad was only 2 years old in 36. I guess my aunts wouldn't have voted in that either because they're 7 and 12. Anyway, it doesn't really matter, right? But it does matter because we got to do it all over again. The election that my grandfather voted in, looks like I'm going to have an opportunity to vote in now too. To put the town in or take out of civil service, right? Has to be done over, which means the chief of police search, I guess the search, anyway, the selection has to be done over again. Hopefully this time, the Board of Selectmen, considering it's it's got two new members, they'll take a more active role in selecting who the next chief of police is for the town of Fairhaven. Not that I'm unhappy with who they selected. Really, I don't know much about it. I never met the man. We have friends in common. I only hear good things about him from the people on the police department now that I'm friendly with. But if the process is wrong, it's wrong. I have to tell you, I had to redo the chief of police search in Freetown. This is no small thing. This is no small thing. So, Fairhaven, we've got to deal with who made the mistake, why was it made, how do you fix it, what are the consequences, think about this. Someone who's been given the job, well, the ramifications of this mistake are enormous. And fortunately, we've got two fresh people on the Board of Selectmen who I believe will take this process seriously and give the control back to the voters, right? In other words, they're our representatives. They represent the taxpayers and the residents of Fairhaven. There's democracy here. So I appreciate that some citizen activists and some other people, obviously, got involved and have gotten to the right answer, because you'd hate to have had this be further down the road when the era was uncovered. So I don't know what's going to happen. I really don't. But you'll find out at WBSM.com because we're going to follow it, WBSM. And I'd love your opinions on this here at WBSM, 508-996-0500. Again, the town of Fairhaven, it looks like they're going to have to unwind the chief of police process, redo a search process. That is really unfortunate for the people that obviously wasted their time participating in the last search. And to the gentleman who was given the job, this is a obviously disturbing development, right? So 508-996-0500. The town of Fairhaven, hey, New Bedford, you're not alone, right? Maybe we share a harbor. We also share some level of incompetence. Some level of not following the rules. I don't know. Where did this happen? What is the genesis of this era? That's important. What is the Board of Selectmen going to do to fix it? Considering that the majority of the board was complicit in this era and the decisions. So it is going to take some people to say, we did the wrong thing, which, I mean, they started right now with this very long press release, which obviously I'm not going to read the entire thing. It's got a little bit of COA in there. Or CYA, not COA, CYA. But this is a major development. Good morning. Thanks for calling.
Good morning, Chris. How are you?
I'm doing well, my friend. How are you? I hope you're getting your boat ready for season.
Yeah, we're getting it all ready. I just hope that you're going to be able to go out on it. You know, I haven't called in a while because it's just been a little bit busy taking care of some health issues. But speaking of that, you were a little bit upset a couple of weeks ago. And what I just want you to do, for us that listen from 9 to 12, you kind of like a combination between the Greek Oracle and Nostradamus for us. You get all these great stories. You've got a magnificent ability to paint pictures for us. We might not all agree with you, and it's kind of like Brian's song. You remember that movie, the Guy Cry movie?
No.
We love Brian Piccolo.
Oh, yeah, I do, yeah.
Yeah, Gale Sayers and Brian Piccolo. They're at the exact opposite ends of the spectrum, but they ended up, that's Brian's song. I love Brian Pickle. Well, we love Chris McCarthy. I don't want to see anything happen to you because you get upset with this stuff, Chris. And I can understand because some of these, even city councilors, they color with big crayons, you know? They finger paint. They're not masterful like you. And just remember one thing, brother. Those paintings aren't going to finger themselves, okay? We need you around. And you're our sounding board, Chris, so... You can get upset about things, but please stick around, okay?
Thanks, Barry. I appreciate it. Barry, we all need you, too. Former chairman of the Board of Appeals in New Bedford. He certainly understands the open meeting law and the importance of it. So and I have confidence that Hank Turgeon will find Ryan Pereira for me, and Ryan will look at his text message, and we'll be good, and we'll get Ryan in here. I'm not going anywhere. If I am, there'll be a big party and you'll all be invited. Some of you will come to make sure I'm really in the box, but I'll be there. But it's not going to be for a while. So what I'm telling you is that the town of Fairhaven, we got a big problem. What is the genesis of this problem? The majority of the Board of Selectmen went along with the process. Clearly, they were given bad information. Where did that bad information come from? And what are you going to do about it, right? It is a... How do I put it? How do you work your whole career to get to the pinnacle of your career as a chief of police and have it taken away from you? That is a destructive moment, right? And I don't know what's going to happen here, but process is important. And I mean, people have made decisions about their careers, retirements, going to other departments based on this process. And you just can't say, oops, sorry, send out a press release. I mean, this deserves major discussion and ramifications from this colossal screw-up, not just for the taxpayers, the people that pay the freight, pay the salaries here in the town of Fairhaven, but the men and women of the police department, people on the fire department. I mean, really, this is a major screw-up. It's injurious to people's careers. People have made life-changing decisions. Whether to stay with the department, retire, leave. People thought they were advancing in their career. They're not. At least not right away. How do you get it this bad? Who pays the ultimate price? I don't know. Fortunately, you got two new selectmen who I think will take the bull by the horns, so to speak. The majority of the select board went along with this decision. They obviously, all five of them, between five people in the town administrator, you would think this could have gotten done right. But obviously, somebody was spoon-fed bad information. Right? Like a baby in a high chair. They were spoon-fed. Five little high chairs. Spoon-fed bad information. I don't know what the genesis of the bad information is, but here we are today. Here we are today, Town of Fairhaven. Again, if you're just learning, if you're just tuning in, Town of Fairhaven has sent out a press release. They screwed up big time. What it means, we don't know yet. I've not had time to do an analysis. This was done as a vote of the town meeting. The town moderator runs the town meeting. He obviously took bad information and went along with this decision because it should not have been done at town meeting. So it should have been ruled by the moderator out of order. So, Mr. Sylvia, you've got some complicity here. It's a major decision. You're the town moderator. Everything that gets done at town meeting is under your control. You should have ruled this out of order. Told them, no, this belongs on the ballot. So, I know you want to be the state representative, but this is not a great start for your campaign. Stick around, folks. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the program. I'm Chris McCarthy, and we're just getting breaking news here that Fairhaven, wow, what a screw-up. What a screw-up. So, looks like the chief of police search is going to have to start over again. Selection process. Now we got two brand-new members of the Board of Selectmen, three of the incumbents who stayed were part of this screw-up. So I really don't know how it's going to break down, but we'll find out. Let's get your calls now. Good morning. Thanks for holding.
Hey, Chris, how you doing?
I'm doing well. How are you?
Good. I know we don't have much time right now, but I will absolutely be calling you tomorrow if you're going to talk about it again.
Absolutely tomorrow.
And I'm going to give you tons of inside information. I was an employee at the department until very recently. I know a lot of everything that's been going on, and that letter's full of lies.
That
letter is not accurate to what's been going on. It is basically trying to go around the things that have happened. Fairhaven is a wreck, and it's a wreck because it is being mismanaged. And the police department is at the top of that list, and it's too bad. Because that police department, I think we all share the fact in Fairhaven that we have been blessed with an amazing police department for a lot of years.
Absolutely, my friend. Listen, call me on the air tomorrow. Reach out to me on Facebook. I want to tell you about a great thing. It's called Citywide Glass. Their mobile tech team is around, okay? They'll come right to your house, to your work. It is Citywide Glass. How do you get them to come to your house to fix that crack in your windshield or your truck sliders or your sunroof? You got to go to citywideglass.net. It's very easy. Book an appointment that way. Or you can call them at their Dartmouth or Fall River location. Look them up. Citywide Glass. There's no reason for you to have that crack in your windshield. Quite frankly, it's dangerous. If your kids have a crack in their windshield, all insurance is accepted. Won't cost you an extra dime. for them to send their mobile team out. Rather than you going to them, they'll come to you. You know that how your wife or your husband has that crack in their windshield and they don't want to get it fixed because they think it's going to take too much time. They don't want to sit there. Do it for them. Call and book an appointment at Citywide Glass, Fairhaven, or rather, they come to Fairhaven, but they're in Fall River and Dartmouth, citywideglass.net. Folks, we just, at the end of the hour, are getting the breaking news. If you follow me on Facebook, you can reach out to me on Messenger there. I'm very easy to find. Again, I want to credit Christina Lopes. She has done a lot of research on this. At least that's where I learned it from, was Christina Lopes. And here we go, folks. Citizen activists, citizen journalists, doing the right thing.